So we're going to take refuge, and then I would like to explain something, and we do a meditation together. So first we take refuge. Chodam sogi chonam la jan chumaru dagni kyam suji dagi jin sogi personam ki dola bencha sangi dumasho sangi chodam sogi chonam la jan chumaru dagni kyam suji dagi jin sogi personam ki dola bencha sangi dumasho Sangye chodam sogi chonam la Chancho baru dagni kyab suji Dagi jin sogi beso nam ki Dola penche sangye duma shum So one meditation that is useful to do regularly is to project you into the future. You see, we cannot stop time. You see, so this second transforms into the next second, which transforms into the next second. So every second we are a second older. Every day we are a day older. See, consciousness is eternal, but it changes from moment to moment. You cannot stop it. So whether you lay on a couch in front of the TV the whole day, or you do something constructive, in both cases time has passed. You're a second closer, you know, to death. So if we use our time constructively, creating a lot of beautiful spiritual imprint, this will carry on when we depart from this life. Whereas if we have a lot of imprint of laziness and destructive behavior, those also come with us. So the only thing that goes on when we leave this body is the imprint in our mind, the habits we have taken. So for us, death seems to be kind. You know, we see other people's corpses, so we infer, you know, that it's dead, no? It's finished. But actually, from the point of view of consciousness, something else happens. You see, when you meditate on the nature of the mind, this nature of the mind right now comes from the second just before. That comes from the second just before. And this moment of awareness turns into the next moment of awareness that turns into the next moment of awareness. So at the time of death, what happens to the consciousness is that the body is not anymore a support for this consciousness. So the consciousness withdraws inside. You see, the four elements are not anymore a base to support consciousness. So the consciousness withdraws into the subtle body, or so to speak, into the central channel. You see, in the central channel. And then from the center channel, it withdraws into the heart chakra. And then from the heart chakra, it exits the body in a dreamlike form, which is an intermediate state body or bardo body, which will be of similar shape than the body of our next rebirth. So death is not an end. Death is simply the consciousness withdrawing from the body, and we very much experience it. You know, it's not just happening and we faint and we pass away. It's something happening to our consciousness. We withdraw from this body gradually, unless we die from an accident or something very very rapid, you know, then the consciousness is kind of ejected from the body. But if you die under normal circumstance, the consciousness withdraws slowly over a number of hours or a number of days. So it's the same consciousness you have right now that you use, you know, to sit here, that you're conscious of. That consciousness simply becomes more and more subtle. So it's a good meditation to do, to understand. You see, how to say, it's not we are meditating about something that's happening to somebody else. We are meditating on something that's going to happen to us definitely. That meditation is what's going to happen to us when we die. Our consciousness is going to go into this process. So to meditate on it is very worthwhile, because somehow, first of all, you're not scared of death like before. It's not like an unknown. It's something, you see, you know what's going to happen. And it helps you to understand what continuity of consciousness is. You see, what rebirth is. What it means to be under the control of karma and delusion. What it means to become free from cyclic existence. So all these things you gradually understand by doing this meditation, but not somehow to say in an intellectual way. It's more like from the core of your being you start seeing it. So in highest yoga tantra, one does this meditation very often. So like His Holiness Dalai Lama, in his book, you know, The Clear Light Mind, he says, you know, I'm doing this meditation 8 times a day. So 8 times a day he goes through the process of his consciousness becoming more subtle and leaving the body. So in Highest Yoga Tantra, you have methods to use this subtler level of consciousness to meditate on reality, meditate on emptiness of inherent existence, and thereby stopping the process, you see, of being in cyclic existence. So we have this ordinary mind that we call the gross mind. Then we have a more subtle level of consciousness, which technically is called the white appearance, red increase, and black near attainment. And during this process, our consciousness becomes subtler, and the gross thought, gross emotion, gross memory stop functioning, because the consciousness is too subtle for those gross state of mind to function. And then when one reaches the most subtle mind of clear light, all these things have ceased functioning. But the mind is very intelligent, very sharp, very clear, very settled. So yogis use this more subtler level of consciousness to meditate on reality, on emptiness of inherent existence, and thereby becoming free from rebirth under the control of karma and delusion. Now a Buddha, you see, never comes down from his most subtle mind of clear light. So this most subtle mind of clear light that realizes emptiness transforms into the omniscient mind of a Buddha. So he never takes back the mind of black near attainment. The red mind and the white mind, and then the level of consciousness related to the four elements. So a Buddha's mind is not like our mind. It's a more subtle mind of clear light mind. So the mind that becomes omniscient is not a gross mind like we have. Is the most subtle mind of clear light. And then a Buddha's body is a subtle, very subtle wind that is inseparable from this most subtle mind of clear light that is transformed into a Buddha's form. And that's the level of consciousness in which are the Pure Lands. So the Pure Lands, you see, they are not at the level of our gross level of consciousness. But for an ordinary being like us, we stay in the clear light mind for a little while. You know, ordinary says up to 3 days. An ordinary person stays in that state for up to 3 days. That's why one says one shouldn't move a body, you know, cremate it too soon. Because that person that has just died has the most blissful and serene experience he ever had. So the mind of clear light is very blissful and very intelligent. So one gets many realizations in that experience. So the time of death is actually our best meditation, you see? So for a person that has trained while alive, dying is actually an incredible experience, an incredible chance to make huge spiritual progress. But for an ordinary being like us, what happens, we come out of the clear light after a certain number of days, you see, and then we take again the grosser level of consciousnesses, you know, black near attainment, red increase, white appearance, and then the four elements. And in that process of our consciousness becoming grosser, the memory, the karma, the habit, everything coalesce, is reactivated within the consciousness. And there we end up in the bardo body, you see, and then we travel around, you see. So a bardo being nourishes itself from odor, from smell, you know? And especially smell of food that has been offered to them. No, so that's in Eastern tradition, there's this ritual or habit to offer food, you know, to people which have deceased. And then one can see people from one's past life, but they cannot see us. You see, we would like to, we are in the body, we want to communicate with the people we knew before, but they cannot see us. So it's kind of frustrating. And then wherever you think, you're very rapidly there. Now you can travel the whole universe just by the speed of thought. And then most of us, out of attachment, within 7 days, we find our parents of our next life, if we're born as human. So we see our parents there, either having sex, or somehow we imagine them having sex, and then our mind is kind of hypnotized by their having sex, or we would like to be one of the partner, or we are kind of hypnotized by the sexual organ, and due to that, mind of being attracted there into this sexual union, then our mind, our consciousness enters the father or the mother and ends up in the mother's womb. So as an intermediate state being, we can travel through mountain, through planets, you know, through trees, through building, but we cannot travel to our mother's womb. So once we enter there, we're kind of trapped, we cannot get out. And then gradually our consciousness, you see, become grosser as our, as the embryo grows. So first the heart chakra is formed, then the central channel, and then around that, you know, the body starts growing. So we spend 9 months in our mother's womb about. See, and then we are kind of ejected from that mother's womb, right? So with great pain we are born into a new with a new body in a new place. And we are, as a small baby, we are completely dependent on other. You know, now we are adult, very independent. You know? But imagine yourself being this small baby again. You cannot even scratch your back. You know, you have to cry and hope your mom figures out what's wrong with you. You know? So you pee on yourself, you shit on yourself, and then the only thing you can, you know, you're uncomfortable, the only thing you can do is cry, you know? You're hungry, the only thing you do, you can cry. So you're completely dependent on others. It's unbearable if you really think about it. And then gradually you have to learn everything anew, how to walk, how to talk, how to function in the world. And then we grow as adult. And time never stops, you see? One moment turns into the next. So we have that life which we experience due to the ripening of positive or negative karma. So the events of our life whether we live in a peaceful place with a certain level of well-being, or we live in a country where there is war and sickness and lots of problem. It's all due to the ripening of a karma. And then again that life ends. You see, again we go through the process of our consciousness withdrawing from that body, ending up in the clear light. So we remain there for a certain amount of time. Then again we leave the clear light with the body of the next intermediate state body. Again we roam in the bardo, looking for our next rebirth. And this process is endless. You see, it has no beginning and no end. Now, as ordinary being, we can be born as human. We can be born as animal, which includes the insects. We can be born as preta, or hungry ghosts. We can be born in the various hells, hot, cold, surrounding, and so forth. We can be born as devas of the and asuras of the desire realm, of the form realm, and the formless realms. So depending on our karma, on our mental afflictions, or on our good qualities, we're born in all these various forms. And each one, each life lasts a certain amount of time, and then we pass away. Again, clear light, intermediate state, and another form. So this is what we call cyclic existence. So imagine for 5 minutes, you see, it's definite that you're going to pass away from this life. It's not maybe it's going to happen or maybe it's not going to happen. There's no doubt that we're going to go through that. So we are going to leave this body and in a clear light, then in the bardo, then next life. So imagine the process of taking rebirth again and dying again and again. Rebirth, dying, intermediate state, rebirth again and again. Just imagine that for a while. You see, you're going to die, so imagine where you're going to die, how you're going to die. And up a clear light, and then imagine your bardo, what it could be like, where you like to be reborn, or how that's going to happen, what you left next life. You know, it's not whether your next life will happen or not, it's definitely you're going to have a next life. So try to imagine your next life, and then growing old from that next life, dying from that next life, going to the clear light of death, bardo, another rebirth. So imagine this process for a while. So now we're going to meditate more specifically how it's happening at the time of death. So imagine, you see, that this life ends. So the karma, that the throwing karma that created this life ends. And we are dying either of an accident or from some sickness or simply from old age. So imagine where you could die, you know, whether you imagine your death at home or in a hospital. So as the body decays, you see, how to say, some heart failure or liver failure or something in our body stops functioning gradually. So our consciousness withdraws from the earth element. So as outer sign, we feel our body very heavy. You feel like your body sinks into the bed. You know, the body is very heavy. And your eyes have difficulty to move. You have that fixed stare. And your consciousness, the space of your awareness, is mirage-like. See, when it's very hot in the summer, you look at the distance on the asphalt, you see this shimmering, as if there was some kind of water there, but there is none. So your consciousness, your space of awareness becomes like that, like mirage-like. So spend a little time trying to imagine, you see, your space of awareness, mirage-like. And then as the process of death further goes along, the consciousness withdraws from the water element. The outer sign is that the liquids in your body start drying out. So you might feel thirst, your mouth dries up, and the water in your eyes dry up. And your consciousness becomes like like a room full of white smoke. See? So imagine your consciousness, the space of your awareness, having this smoke-like appearance. And then is the fire element that dissolves. So the heat of your body starts decreasing from its extremity towards the heart. And your consciousness, the space of your awareness, seems to be filled with dancing fireflies. Then as the air element of your body ceases to function, you stop breathing. And then your consciousness becomes like a dim light, like the glow of a candle flame. So by now, you're quite remote within you from your body and from your surrounding. You can still hear, but it's very far away. Even though people might be just next to you, they seem to be in another room. So then in the subtle body, the drop at the crown chakra starts moving towards the heart chakra. And as that process happens, your consciousness becomes more subtle. And it is like a white light. Like the sky just before sunrise, or another image given is like a countryside covered with snow, illuminated by the full moon. Your consciousness becomes very spacious. There's no more feeling of body, just pure consciousness. And there's no more duality, subject-object. And the 80 indicative conception start dissolving from the gross to the subtle, from the gross to the medium to the subtle. So gradually your attachments, your aversion, your memories, all these things start dissolving into more subtle levels, more subtle levels. So imagine being this space, this non-dual space of white light. And then as the red drop from the lower chakra starts traveling up towards the heart chakra in your subtle body, the space of your awareness turns orange-red. So it's even more spacious than the one before, more blissful, and still no subject and object distinction. So the minimum level of the 80 indicative conception disappear. So at that moment you are this spacious orange-red light space. And then as these two drops meet in the heart, the consciousness in the subtle body becomes trapped within this drop at the heart. And then the space of your awareness turns dark. So it's like the sky at night when there's no sun, no moon and no stars. So there's this feeling of spaciousness, but there's no light. Again, there's no duality, subject and object, and the subtle level of the indicative conception have stopped. So the last part of the mind of black near attainment, one kind of faint, kind of loses awareness as the consciousness withdraws from the subtle body into the very subtle body mind at the heart chakra. And there we end up in this blissful, clear light. It says it's like bright, like a space illuminated by 1,000 suns, but with no suns. Just a blissful, bright space of non-dual awareness. So this is our most subtle level of consciousness and the most blissful experience we can have. So that mind is very sharp, very intelligent. And there's no duality subject-object. So a meditator will use this time to realize how things really exist. An ordinary person doesn't know how to use that experience. He just has that experience. So an ordinary person can remain in that blissful, non-dual space of bright awareness up to 3 days. So try to imagine your consciousness being subtle, being this really bright, blissful space of non-dual awareness. And you don't need concentration at that stage, you have natural concentration. So an advanced yogi would transform that into the omniscient mind and never leave that level of consciousness. A medium level practitioner would come out of that with an illusory body. Created by his meditation. An ordinary person comes out of that experience with the intermediate state body. So then imagine that some winds, some movement happen in this space of clear light, and you're back into the black space. Night without moon, without stars. Then this turns into the red-orange space of awareness. That turns into the white space of awareness. And this turns in the candle flame type of awareness. This turns into the firefly space of awareness. This turns into the white smoke awareness. This turns into the mirage awareness. And then you arise as the from that experience, you arise with your within your intermediate state body. So it says it's about the size of a child of 6 years old, so about a forearm length. So it's like a dream body, a light energy body. And if you're born, for example, as human, you see other beings in the intermediate state that are also be born as human. And then your karma, the imprints in your consciousness ripen, so your habit your longings, your aversions, your memories, all things come up again. And due to that, your interest and so forth, you travel this space, you might visit people you had known, but they cannot see you. And then you move about exploring this intermediate space. And it says if within 7 days you haven't found your next rebirth, again you go to a small death. Again, you go through this eighth vision into the clear light. And you arise again from this clear light in the reverse stage in a new intermediate state body. And again, you wander around this intermediate state. And that up to 7 times. So it is sure within 49 days you have found your place of rebirth. So imagine you see your parents, your future parents, and due to karma you are attracted to them. They are not just any other couple. There's something in them that attracts you, like a magnet. And then you imagine having them sex, or you actually see them having sex. And that makes you enter either through the crown of the head of your father and go down through his body into the mother's womb, or directly into the mother. Then imagine that you enter the mother's womb and mix with the sperm and ovum and there your consciousness becomes linked. And then you cannot get out anymore, you cannot leave the mother's womb. So as the embryo grows and the gross element of the body formed, a new consciousness grows within that. And when the sixth sense organ are formed, you start experiencing the outer world, still in the mother's womb, but you can feel the heat, the cold, the movement and so forth. And then after 9 months, you imagine that your body is, the head is put upside down and you're kind of pushed out of your mom's body into a new life. So in the West, we are, you know, common people are completely ignorant of this knowledge of the death process, intermediate state and rebirth. Whereas yogis, I think it's not just Tibetan yogis, I think in the Hindu tradition, certain yogis have similar kind of a knowledge. So it's very important to do this meditation from time to time. So we can prepare our mind for what's going to happen. Now in Highest Yoga Tantra, there is a method not only to experience this level of consciousness in an imaginary way, the way we did, you actually induce your mind to actually experience them by controlling the wind in your body. You know, you activate the subtle body, then you meditate on the wind, drop and channel. So you actually activate those level of consciousness while you are alive, and you train yourself to use them to realize emptiness of ignorant existence. So there's a whole set of meditation that you can learn to actually control the process, and then how to use it. How to use that experience to realize the emptiness of inherent existence and thereby becoming free of cyclic existence. So in Highest Yoga Tantra it says the best opportunity to become enlightened is at the time of death, because you're not meditating with the ordinary mind, you're not meditating with the subtle mind, but you're meditating with a subtle, very subtle mind of clear light. So advanced practitioner can separate the subtle mind from the gross mind and separate the very subtle mind from the subtle mind in meditation. Certain people can do that. So there's methods bring this about, in Highest Yoga Tantra, one learns these meditations and then uses it, this more subtle level of consciousness, to become enlightened. So whether one is successful or not depends on many things, but at the time of death we all experience this clear light mind. So our best chance is at that moment. So if we have trained during our life, you see, through this process, we're so familiarized. So when it's actually going to happen, we know exactly what to do at each stage, how to meditate, you know? And then we can actually use this clear light mind to either become Buddha or to arise, you know, as a highly advanced yogi with an illusory body. Or we can actually have control of, if we cannot reach that level, at least we can have control over the bardo and control our next rebirth. So His Holiness says he's going through this process 8 times a day. Can you imagine? 8 times a day you go through this process of going to more subtle level of consciousness and stay in the clear light mind. You know? And then of course this is in the context of his tantric practices. So, you know, there's many things happening there. So he says when he's going to clear light, you know, for himself, each time he goes to clear light, actually he stops breathing for a while. So meaning that his experience is quite profound. But he says, you see, because of his lack of time, he cannot, prolong that experience very much. But he says, I'm sure other yogis can stay much longer without breathing in that state of clear light. So this is not just Tibetan fairy tale. You see, there are actual yogis and yoginis that have those experience. And those traditions are still very much alive nowadays. So it says, through the sutra path, it takes 3 countless great eons to reach enlightenment. So it's a huge amount of time. And by using this more subtler level of consciousness to meditate in the Vajrayana, you can reach enlightenment within a maximum of 16 lives. Even if you don't meditate, just by keeping your vows, you know, your pratimoksha, bodhisattva and tantric vows, you know, just by keeping those, you are able to reach enlightenment within 16 lives. And then if you meditate, you know, maybe within 3 lives, or even shorter than that. Okay, half hour break, sorry.